Good evening, good afternoon, and good morning to everyone. My name is Jonathan Dunn, and I'm the MC for this conference. I would like to welcome you to this second day of the IMF and the University of Tokyo virtual conference on lessons from the global financial crisis in the age of COVID-19. Thank you for joining us. And a special welcome to all of our speakers, moderators, and panelists who are making this event possible, and to the officials from throughout Asia and the Pacific who are joining us. Now I would like to invite Mr. Haruhiko Kuroda, Governor of Bank of Japan, to deliver his opening remarks. The floor is yours, Mr. Kuroda.
It is my great honor to speak today at this virtual conference co-hosted by the International Monetary Fund and the University of Tokyo. It has been a decade since the global financial crisis, or GFC, and two decades since Japan's financial crisis and the Asian financial crisis. Today, we are facing a new crisis triggered by the spread of COVID-19. This conference is intended to learn from our past experience and to gain insight into how best to respond to these extremely challenging circumstances. In this sense, the conference could hardly be more timely. The spread of COVID-19 has had an even greater impact on the global economy than the GFC. The GDP growth rate for the April-June quarter of 2020 declined substantially in many countries. Moreover, due to concerns over the deterioration in the real economy, global financial markets temporarily became volatile in March. There was a sudden drop in the prices of stocks and credit assets. The CP and corporate bond markets became frozen, and there were substantial outflows of capital from emerging economies. In response to these developments, governments, central banks, and the international organizations have been swift to implement policy response measures, both fiscal and monetary, on an unprecedented scale. These responses have helped economic entities with their financing, markets to regain stability earlier than in the case of the GFC, and the global economy to start picking up. I would point to three particularly important elements in the policy responses taken so far to address the impact of COVID-19. The first is that swift and abundant liquidity provision by central banks and international organizations prevented the materialization of a negative feedback loop between economic and financial activities. One of the lessons learned from the GFC is that if market confidence is undermined amid heightening uncertainty, there is a possibility of the real economy and finance falling into an adverse spiral. There would be a significant credit contraction as financial institutions' funding becomes difficult. Mindful of these risks, central banks have played a considerable role in recovering market confidence, acting as the global lender of last resort with ample liquidity provisioning and US dollar swap line arrangements. These measures have worked as a bulwark against the global negative feedback loop. Unlike the GFC, the spread of COVID-19 has been a shock to the real economy. Nevertheless, a risk common to both the GFC and the COVID-19 crisis was that the erosion of market confidence would trigger a negative feedback loop. However, liquidity provisioning this time was conducted decisively. Many central banks enhanced swap line arrangements and conducted US dollar fund provisions and asset purchases, while the IMF promptly reinforced its emergency financial assistance. I believe that these actions were driven by common concern over risks built upon the experience of the GFC. The second key element of the COVID-19 policy responses is the coordination of fiscal and monetary policies implemented to stabilize the economy and the financial system. This was seen at the time of the GFC, but the coordination this time has been more prompt and comprehensive. Amid the rapid decline in income due to the impact of COVID-19, governments have implemented large-scale economic measures, including income support and loan guarantees to firms and households, while central banks have introduced powerful monetary easing measures aimed at supporting corporate financing and stabilizing financial markets. Regarding corporate financing support in particular, fiscal measures provided credit enhancement through government guarantee programs, while monetary policy provided liquidity. As fiscal and monetary policy measures fulfill their respective roles, business operations and employment have been underpinned through the smooth functioning of financial intermediation. The third important element centers on regulation and supervision. Namely, while financial institutions have already been increasing their robustness in line with international financial regulations, financial authorities swiftly implemented the necessary measures. The strengthening of international financial regulations in the wake of the GFC has led to financial institutions building up ample capital and liquidity. This worked as intended, providing a backstop against the negative feedback loop as the financial sector absorbed the shock to the real economy rather than exacerbating it. Moreover, I believe the deferral of the full implementation of the Basel III standards by 1 year and the encouragement for banks to use their capital and liquidity buffers, among other measures, have contributed to securing the smooth functioning of financial intermediation. Next, I would like to consider what will be required of future policy responses. There continue to be considerable uncertainty reflecting the resurgence of the spread of COVID-19. It is therefore essential for the time being to ensure the stability of the economy and the financial system by continuing steadily with the responses to date. On this point, due attention must be paid to the possibility that a shift in the challenges facing firms and households from liquidity to solvency could affect the future financial system. In the long run, the risk of new financial imbalances must also be borne in mind. After Japan's financial crisis and the GFC, such imbalances, including balance sheet adjustments due to excess debt, exerted prolonged downward pressure on the economy. Moreover, just as the GFC was followed by regulatory and supervisory reforms in the financial sector, it will be important to learn from the experience of COVID-19. For example, destabilization of the market at the time of the outbreak highlighted the growing importance in financial intermediation of non-banks, namely MFFs and investment funds. It will be necessary to examine carefully the structural changes in the financial system. Society as a whole must prepare for such structural changes in the relatively long run as the impact of COVID-19 is likely to eventually subside. Some of these challenges were with us before the spread of the disease, such as demographic changes and climate change. Moreover, digitalization and cybersecurity are becoming increasingly important with the spread of COVID-19. These initiatives are likely to be a driving force for raising the potential growth rate of the global economy in the post-COVID-19 era. Facing such uncertain future, international cooperation is increasingly important in tackling these challenges. Now, more than ever, it is essential to share the knowledge we have gained and make progress in cooperation with each other. I would like to close my remarks with the heartfelt wish that this conference will be an important step toward this goal. Thank you for your kind attention.
I realized I was muted. My apologies. Too late. A huge thank you to Mr. Kuroda for sharing his views on all of the key topics covered in this conference and stressing the importance of international cooperation, of maintaining market confidence to prevent spillovers and to protect financial intermediation, the payoffs from past regulatory reform and the challenges ahead in this area, and the potential pressures building in the financial system as the crisis continues. Next, we would like to invite Mr. Jonathan Ostry, Acting Director, the Asia and Pacific Department of the IMF, to make his presentation. Jonathan will talk about the outlook and how countries in Asia are navigating the pandemic crisis. Please give us a moment while Jonathan comes online and then starts sharing his slides. Thank you.
Thank you, Jonathan. And konbanwa to our friends in Japan and participants joining us from Japan, and warm greetings from Washington. Good morning and good afternoon to those who are joining from different locations. Let me share my screen. Good. So good. So in this presentation, I'll begin with a broad overview of the global conjuncture, covering the snapshot we released during our annual meetings last month, as well as relevant updates since. I'll then turn to focus on Asia specifically, which entered the crisis first and already offers some valuable lessons for the rest of the world. And here I'll draw on our regional flagship, the Asia-Pacific Economic Outlook, both its conjunctural and thematic chapters. So let me begin with the global context. Global GDP is expected to contract by some 4.4% in 2020. By way of comparison, during the global financial crisis, global growth was close to zero. So beyond the unprecedented scale of this recession, of note also is the unique composition, with the services sector being hit especially hard. Third quarter GDP growth outcomes have generally surprised to the upside compared to our October forecast, especially so in Europe. However, new waves of the pandemic in many parts of the world make us cautious about the course of the global economy. New COVID cases are again on an upward trajectory, especially so in advanced countries. This has stalled the reopening process and has led to the reimposition of restrictions in several countries. Let me now zoom in on the Asia-Pacific region. Asia is where the pandemic began and it appears also the region that is emerging first from its economic ravages. Decisive policy actions helped many countries in the region contain the first wave of the virus, often with greater success than in other regions. In some cases, of course, new waves of or localized outbreaks have emerged. More discouragingly, however, a few countries are still striving to flatten the virus curve and substantially reduce cases. Across the region, decisions have been taken to exit from nationwide lockdowns. But the exits have proceeded at varying speeds, reflecting differences in the progress achieved in contending with the pandemic. And in some countries, restrictions have been retightened following new waves. Countries are also opening up different sectors at different rates. Many sectors are now completely open or working with enhanced health protocols. But some significant restrictions remain in place. Notably, external borders are closed in most countries. As containment measures are rolled back, economic activity is picking up. After a record decline in the second quarter, latest GDP data are showing a significant recovery in the third quarter. Manufacturing PMIs have recovered, surpassing first quarter levels. Service sector PMIs, which cover a broad range of services beyond just the more abundant contact intensive sectors, have also improved significantly in the third quarter and in October. The recovery is most advanced in China. As with the rest of the world, financial conditions in Asia have eased as a result of actions by major central banks early in the crisis. Stock markets have recouped earlier losses, and the sharp and unprecedented portfolio capital outflows earlier this year have stabilized. The pandemic is, however, taking a severe toll on Asia's labor markets. Labor market indicators have already deteriorated more than during the global financial crisis. Of note, labor force participation has plunged. Female and younger workers, with their outsized presence in trade and services, have been hit the hardest. Let me now turn to our forecasts for the Asia-Pacific region. Projections we released during our annual meetings were for a 2.2% contraction in the region in 2020, easily the most severe contraction in living memory. We also projected growth to pick up only gradually in 2021 to 6.9%, with the level of GDP remaining well below pre-COVID projections. Of particular note is the very sharp downgrade to our forecast for India. Bucking this trend, China's outlook has improved, reflecting the impressive bounce back following the lockdowns in the first quarter. Since October, there has been both positive and negative news, but the big picture remains the same. We continue to expect the recovery to be drawn out. In Asia, potential output in 2025 is projected to be, on average, some 5% lower than our pre-pandemic forecast. The extent of scarring will vary across countries, depending on the economy's dependence on sectors most hit by the pandemic, such as tourism, the policy response, and structural factors affecting the economy's ability to reallocate resources effectively. Let me turn now to some risks. On the upside, there is the recent positive news on vaccine development. But caution because of the huge production and distribution challenges that lie ahead. And the many downsides that informed the risk profile a couple months ago seem very much still to be with us, clouding the outlook for 2021 and beyond. I'll start with some of the external risks. Tensions between China and the United States on trade, financial flows, technology and geopolitics continue to cloud the outlook. Model-based simulations indicate that a U.S.-China decoupling could reduce real GDP in China by some 4% over a decade, with spillovers to the rest of Asia of broadly a similar magnitude. These effects reflect the depressing impact on trade in high-tech products, on productivity as countries move toward inefficient production, and on knowledge diffusion, so essential for medium-run productivity growth. On the other hand, the recent signing of the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership by 15 countries reaffirms Asia's commitment to open trade and greater regional integration. The ratification of the agreement will create the world's largest free trade area, with implications for regional supply chains and potential upside for medium-term growth. The second risk I want to flag is worsening balance sheets of the public and private sectors alike. Many corporates and households in Asia already entered the pandemic with too much leverage, much more so than before the GFC. And the economic contractions are likely to worsen vulnerabilities going forward. Corporate profitability in Asia has weakened since the global financial crisis. And corporate sector vulnerability, measured by low interest coverage ratios, has increased since the beginning of the pandemic. In many countries, firms have been relying on quasi-fiscal support to service debt, raising fears of rising shares of zombie firms in the region. While banks have built large capital buffers since the GFC, non-performing loans are rising, and the protracted slowdown is increasing financial sector vulnerabilities, especially in Asian emerging market and low-income countries. NPLs could rise even more sharply if deferred loans become impaired over time. Weak sovereign balance sheets also constitute a major risk going forward. The median public debt to GDP ratio is ticking up in the region, and the outlook is for further increases. Given the elevated vulnerabilities, sovereign debt ratings have been downgraded for several Asian emerging markets. For many, balancing the multiple goals of pandemic recovery, rebuilding fiscal buffers, and investing in climate resilience is proving to be exceptionally difficult. Income and wealth inequality, which was already rising in Asia before the pandemic, seems likely to rise further unless decisive measures are taken to change course. This is the sobering message from past pandemics. What lies behind this story is the greater burden of economic dislocations on those at the bottom of the economic ladder, notably those with minimal education and skills, and whose job losses seem the likeliest to be permanent. A risk we highlighted in our regional economic outlook last month is for increased inequality to morph into social unrest, as those at the bottom lose hope that better times lie ahead. What then are the priorities for managing the pandemic, supporting the recovery, and transitioning to sustainable, inclusive, green growth? An early public health response, when infection rates are still low, has been essential to achieve a flattening of the virus in Asia as elsewhere in the world. On this front, Asia did particularly well in comparison to other regions, probably due to its experience with previous pandemics. Relaxing containment measures only after the virus has been suppressed is also associated with better economic outcomes. On this front, Asia likewise did well, with most countries reopening their economies when new cases were low, which has paved the way for a strong economic rebound. Going forward, the ability of countries to contain the virus without resorting to strict lockdowns will be a key driver of economic outcomes. In this context, supporting the reopening with strong testing and contact tracing policies will help to reduce the risk of second and third waves. In addition, countries which have yet to bring the outbreak under control need to find a way to achieve better outcomes. All countries urgently need to plan now to secure adequate vaccine supplies when they become available, while simultaneously developing distribution strategies to avoid bottlenecks. As highlighted by Governor Kuroda, a coordinated fiscal and monetary policy response has played a crucial role in stabilizing the global economy. Partly based on lessons from the GFC, countries in Asia and around the world stepped up decisively and quickly to provide essential fiscal policy support, helping to put a floor under the regional economy. That said, a lot of this support has been in the form of loan guarantees and other quasi-fiscal below-the-line measures, which tend to have lower multipliers. Monetary policy has also played its part in limiting the downturn. Fiscal policy is particularly effective when economic activity is depressed. Our simulations also show that fiscal measures that are targeted to where needs are greatest are more effective than general handouts in supporting both economic activity and health. We are not out of the woods yet. In this uncertain environment, it is better to do more rather than less. Macroeconomic policy support should be maintained until the recovery is entrenched. As fiscal space is scarce everywhere, better targeting to protect the most vulnerable, youth, women, and informal workers, is needed to save lives, livelihoods, and reverse the unwelcome increase in inequality. Credible medium-term fiscal strategies are needed to anchor public debt sustainability. Where necessary, unsustainable debt should be addressed proactively. Monetary policy has its part to play, remaining supportive while output gaps remain large and inflation low. Corporate vulnerabilities are a growing concern and will require a comprehensive approach, as I'll now explain. For the corporate sector, the duration of the pandemic is making it increasingly difficult to distinguish between liquidity shortfalls and solvency problems. Firms must face incentives to restructure, overcome debt overhangs, and retool. Policy options on three fronts is needed. Policy action on three fronts is needed. Reinforcing private debt resolution frameworks, ensuring adequate financing to support corporate restructuring, and facilitating access to risk capital. Such reforms would lead to a stronger equity culture and stimulate entry of new firms, as well as exits of non-viable ones. Labor market policies are also needed to prevent worker disengagement and skill erosion. Enhancing training programs, improving skill matching, and lightening the regulatory and financial cost of hiring are priorities. As Governor Kuroda said, the global nature of the shock and large spillovers underscore the need for multilateral cooperation. Developing countries urgently need financing and support for making vaccines and treatment available to their populations. Cooperation is also needed to help defuse trade tensions and address gaps in the rules-based multilateral trading system. To summarize, we are seeing a multi-speed recovery emerging in the Asia-Pacific region, but everywhere the recovery is far from entrenched and there are significant downside risks. Macro policy support must not be withdrawn prematurely, that is, before the recovery has gained traction. Further efforts to reduce scarring and improve the economy's ability to efficiently reallocate resources and generate inclusive and greener growth must be priorities in the period ahead. Thank you for your kind attention and best wishes for an interesting set of discussions during the remainder of the conference.
Thank you very much, Jonathan, for laying out so clearly the current economic situation and outlook in both the global and Asia-Pacific context for everyone attending this conference and for also sharing with us some macroeconomic and policy priorities going forward. We also take note of your emphasis on the financial risks that are emerging from various angles as the current crisis continues. This is highly relevant for this conference. Now we would like to move on to today's first session on international efforts to bolster cooperation and manage financial stability in the era of COVID-19. The moderator of this session is Mr. Takahiko Nakao, Chairman of the Mizuho Research Institute. Mr. Nakao will also introduce the panelists. Now I would like to give the floor to Mr. Nakao. Please give us a moment as we connect everyone. Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Dan, can I start?
Yes, you can start.
Okay, thank you very much for the introduction, Mr. Dan. And I'm very happy and honored to be a moderator of this session. And as a former president of Asian Development Bank, I really appreciate the international efforts to come together for discussing such an important issue today. Although there are still so many uncertainties and it's very difficult to tell the definite things, but still I think it's worth talking about these issues. So let me introduce today's panelists who are from different kind of experiences. And first, Seila-san and SPR director at the IMF. And I was once a PDR economist, so I'm really appreciating your participation. And you'll cover the important issues of G20 and regional frameworks and also IMF efforts to bolster this situation. And she has a very long experiences in World Bank Group also in addition to the IMF, and she also worked for private sector. And Mr. Kono, or the my mate at the peer at the Ministry of Finance, and we joined the Ministry of Finance in the same year. But he's the most respectable person among my peers because of his integrity and intelligence. And he was a very great expert of financial sector. He worked for financial service agency. And also he was a chairman of important committees of IOSCO, International Organization for Security Commissions. And he's now OECD Deputy Secretary General, so he can speak about financial sector issues and other important issues of the world. And finally, Mr. Doi, and he's also the same from Ministry of Finance, and he's now the director of AMRO, ASEAN Plus 3 Macroeconomic Group, and he may discuss the important issues for ASEAN Plus 3. And as Mr. Astri said, Asia is relatively doing better, especially China. Korea is also doing well, and Vietnam. So I think he can share the important experiences of these countries. So Seila-san, please start your discussion. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Nakao-san, and greetings to all. It's really a pleasure to be a part of this very important event, and I look forward to the discussion with all of you. And greetings to all, and thanks for participating in this conference. So I would appreciate if the slides could be uploaded. I think colleagues are helping put up the slides. Thank you. Thank you very much. Next slide, please. So I will first talk about some of the similarities and differences between the global financial crisis and what we call this unfortunate pandemic, the Great Lockdown, which has been really a challenge for all of us to manage. So in terms of the differences, the nature of the shock has been, of course, very different. The global financial crisis was a financial crisis, as the name suggests, and it hit mainly advanced economies. Of course, it had implications through capital markets and so on emerging markets. But as you can see in this chart, the impact on output GDP growth was much more pronounced for advanced economies. But then if you look at this crisis, which was driven by the virus, it has hit all countries. We see severe growth declines in all countries, be it advanced economies, developing emerging markets, or developing economies. So it has been the case that the health crisis turned into an economic crisis due to the measures that had to be taken to deal with, to manage the pandemic. If we could go to the next slide, please. And of course, the initial conditions were very different in different countries. We had several globally important financial institutions which entered the global financial crisis with highly leveraged balance sheets. And of course, we also saw impact on some of the European financial institutions. But if you look at this crisis, we actually started it with pretty much across the board record high levels of public and private debt, and for some countries, very limited fiscal space. If we could go to the next slide, please. And the initial response has been very forceful, both by the fiscal and monetary authorities. This chart shows the discretionary fiscal, as well as in orange, the loan guarantees and other credit measures that have been taken by the fiscal authorities and central banks, as the governor also talked about these some of these issues. When we look at the global financial crisis, we saw very also among some of the advanced economies, like in the US, there was the TARP, and in Europe, the response in terms of putting in place swap lines and central bank packages. So there was response during the global financial crisis. In this crisis, the response has been even more stronger, and including also, of course, the fiscal authorities. But it has been very uneven. As you see in this chart, advanced economies on average were able to put in 20% of GDP. Emerging markets, that number goes down to 6%. And for low-income countries, it's less than 2%. So what this crisis is also being called the great unequalizer because of this uneven response for many countries. As Jonathan mentioned, this will lead to scarring, unfortunately, and uneven recovery for some countries unless measures are taken. During the global financial crisis, measures were taken, and that helped prepare the ground for international responses. If you during the global financial crisis, the global financial safety net was strengthened considerably, both in terms of resources for the IMF, other international institutions, but also it became much stronger, the global financial safety net, with the inclusion, the setup and augmentation of regional financing arrangements. And we have Mr. Doi and others in this panel who can talk more about the regional financing arrangements, which have been really critical in terms of strengthening the global financial safety net and helping countries. The establishment of standing bilateral swap arrangements, BSAs, among reserve currency issuing central banks have also been an important feature of the GFC, which also helped, of course, in this crisis. So if we could go to the next slide, where I want to talk about key lessons in terms of international collaboration going forward. As Jonathan also mentioned, it's very important that we make sure that we don't think of the rebound as recovery, because this is a crisis which is very uncertain. We have the second and third waves, unfortunately, in some countries now. So it's very important that we don't make the mistake of the global financial crisis. I remember a year after 2008, we were all starting to think, okay, looks like things are looking up, but then we were hit with the Eurozone crisis, Euro area crisis. So I think it's very important that we look carefully at the fiscal space that countries have and do not exit early from stimulus packages, because this is going to be very important in order to make sure that we recover with less scarring and as well as possible. We could go to the next slide, please. It's important to deal early on with insolvencies. In the global financial crisis, it was very important to do the diagnostics and take action to deal with non-performing loans and insolvent financial institutions. Countries that did that sooner recovered much quicker from the impact of the crisis. There were asset management companies, distressed asset sales, some of which were lessons actually from earlier crises, the Asian financial crisis, emerging market crisis, which took place in the 1990s. And the countries where we saw consolidation in the banking sector and dealing with issues like structural issues, profitability, governance, leverage, and so on, actually did much better. In this crisis, it's going to be also very important to deal with unsustainable public debt, which we had seen at the G20. We work very closely, of course, with the World Bank, other MDBs, on really putting together the debt service suspension initiative, which dealt with liquidity issues. And now common framework has just been endorsed by the G20 last week, which will deal with potential debt reduction necessary in some of the countries. We of course also need to work on debt, reforming the debt architecture. We go to the next slide, please. And I have one more slide after this. It's very important that we prepare for the next crisis and minimize its cost. The global financial crisis led to an unprecedented regulatory response. Liquidity, quality, and quantity of capital was improved. Leverage measures were taken. Governance, resolution, architecture, bail-in, all these unprecedented measures at the led by the Financial Stability Board and the G20, led to a much stronger financial sector, which I think helped us so far in this crisis and hopefully will continue to provide the way forward as, of course, corporate sector will go into more difficulties. And that's very important, as I said before, to put in place insolvency measures like out-of-court settlement systems and so on. This crisis, we need to be going forward, we need to be prepared for dealing with pandemics going forward. We need to be prepared also above and beyond what we have seen, because as we understand from earlier crises, it's really critical that we work together in a coordinated manner across institutions, across countries, to deal with potential issues like the digital divide, inequality, climate change. So as much as possible, we need to take action, not only to deal with the aftermath of this crisis, but also prepare the institutions and international collaboration necessary for potential issues, potential shocks that may come our way going forward. And finally, if I could finish with the next slide, we have been talking about this issue, the need for dealing with the climate change, also the need for more jobs, more growth, and therefore looking at the possibilities of a global a collective rather infrastructure push where we could have a greener and more sustainable recovery. This of course will depend very much on the trend of the pandemic and the potential fiscal space countries have, but as much as possible it will be important to emerge from this crisis and prepare the field for being able to make these investments, which will help both jobs and growth, but also a more sustainable and equitable growth. Thank you very much, and over to you.
Mr. Nakao, you're muted.
Thank you, Asela-san. So, Mr. Kono, floor is yours.
Thank you, Nakao-san, and for your kind introduction. And My great honor and pleasure to be here today and with so many familiar faces. It's really much a pleasure. Now, the previous speakers have been very comprehensive in actually laying out the issues and assessing the current situation and talking about the future. So I may perhaps focus a bit on what kind of recovery that we want to have and how we can get there. And by the way, I don't have any nice slides to present, so please bear with me for the next 5 minutes or so. Well, this pandemic has really disrupted so many essential elements of our economies and societies, as already explained by our previous speakers. And this ranges from, of course, global supply chains to healthcare to education, consumer spending. But of course, global finance has not been an exception. But in coping with the issues in global finance, I think we can say that the lessons learned from the global financial crisis a decade ago have been certainly useful, but of course there needs to be more work to make the system more resilient. And well, if I just go back a little into history, and please allow me for that. In the lead up to the global financial crisis, we really underestimated the fragility of the financial system, its potential effects on the real economy, and basically, I think it's fair to say that we were not well prepared. In the case of Japan, financial safety nets and safeguards built during its own banking crisis did help a lot in maintaining trust and confidence in the financial system, but the real economy was still hit hard, and finance was certainly partly to blame. And of course, during the GFC, we saw fear and greed interacting with the prevailing macroeconomic conditions, and also regulation and supervision were not strong enough, and therefore there was a problem in loss of confidence and trust in the system. And this is despite the quick actions of the central banks to inject liquidity into the system. Now, we just heard from Governor Kuroda that, of course, this time this quick injection of liquidity was even faster and also more coordinated. There was an explosion of leverage also during the GFC, but it was boosted by shadow banking. And the demand side was in such complex and let's say hard to assess instruments such as CDOs, CLOs, mortgage-backed securities, CDS, and so on. So many acronyms. But when asset values turned, again, confidence and trust easily collapsed, and leverage certainly, which of course has helped the great moderation, now instantly turned into a ruthless enemy in a way. And well, we saw the speed at which the crisis spread and its consequences for the global economy. And of course, we saw how interconnected the financial system was and the intensity of global repercussions. And now the question is, how much has it changed? And for one, myself having served on the Financial Stability Board since 2009, I'm tempted to say that it has become a lot better, and we're better prepared. But well, in a way, certainly we have introduced stronger regulatory requirements for banks, worked on extending the regulatory perimeters to non-banks and rating agencies as well. We have much better financial reporting standards to enable expected loss provisioning. We have much stronger international cooperation amongst financial regulators and supervisors. And there are many tools to restrain excessive leverage and mitigate counterparty risk and protect payment systems. So With all this, of course, I can say that the progress has been made in better addressing risks and instability in finance, while, of course, ensuring that the financial sector plays its key role of finance in the real economy. But this crisis is again testing the usefulness of the more stringent regulatory requirements and supervision, because now the issue is to run down the buffers as they were designed to be, and to enable banks and non-bank financial intermediaries to provide adequate finance to the real economy while maintaining the resilience of the financial system. Tighter regulation and supervision certainly need to be complemented by policies which ensure the smooth functioning of financial markets, remove impediments to financial innovation, strengthen and make more efficient international and domestic payment systems, and enable long-term investment by broadening the range of financial instruments and introducing incentives where necessary to reallocate capital to foster new sources of growth and sustainability. So the big challenge is still there. And moreover, I think we need to be creative and also be making the best use of digitalization and innovation. So take one step back, and we must accept that there will be new crises in finance in the future. There's no way that we cannot have another crisis, although the cause may be different. And the systemic threats that modern societies face are becoming more and more complex. And this includes, of course, climate change, biodiversity loss, risks of future pandemics, and so on, but cyber threats as well. But it's becoming so complex that using traditional approaches of economic modeling and risk assessment may not be adequate. And at the OECD, actually, we have been calling for resilience-based approaches to prepare for future challenges. Such approaches certainly strengthen a system's ability to absorb, recover from, and adapt to a wide range of upheavals. And resilience could include more efficient policy approaches for economic recovery and adaptation in the aftermath of an exogenous shock. We can never fully anticipate the wide universe of possible issues or threats that may arise in years to come, but it is arguably possible to engineer and adjust the various facets of global finance in a manner that is more sustainable and recovery driven instead of driven by short-termism and backward looking. And so this COVID crisis is certainly a clear reminder and also an opportunity that we can use to build a more resilient system. That is, we want to make this recovery strong and resilient, inclusive and sustainable. Now, inclusive is, of course, important, as Jayla explained in her slide. Certainly inequalities are rising. So in all this, international cooperation is key. But if I may come back to what maybe the financial regulators and standard setting bodies through international cooperation can do is to, of course, monitor the risks in lightly regulated sectors, particularly the non-bank sector, but not limited to that. There will be pockets of fragility. And then we should watch the movements of capital markets more closely. There seems to be a certain disconnect these days between movements in financial markets and the real economy, and that requires close attention. And create incentives for building reserve capacity and buffers once the acute crisis period is over. And diversify supply chains. This is also quite important. This is for both the financial and non-financial sectors, of course. So I think this focus on a resilient and sustainable recovery is certainly something that is quite important at this phase. Thank you. I look forward to the discussions.
Thank you very much. Mr. Doi, it's your turn.
Thank you very much, Mr. Nakao. First of all, on behalf of Sample 3 Macroeconomic Research Office, I would like to thank the organizers for inviting us to this very timely event. ASEAN Plus 3 Macroeconomic Research Office, or AMRO in short, is an international organization conducting economic surveillance of ASEAN Plus 3 countries and providing operational support to the CMIM or the Chiang Mai Initiative Multilateralization, which is a region's financial safety net. The ASEAN Plus 3 countries are, as you know, the 10 ASEAN countries, together with Japan, China, and Korea. And today, I would like to focus my remarks on the issues facing the ASEAN Plus 3 countries. It has been almost a year since the outbreak of the coronavirus. Although our region has also been hit hard by the pandemic, it remains relatively contained vis-a-vis the rest of the world. While the region accounts for around 30% of the global population, it only accounts for around 2% of the coronavirus cases. However, in terms of economic impact, this region has been hit equally hard. With the exception of China, all countries experienced sharp decline in economic growth in the second quarter this year, caused by various stringent lockdown measures. AMRO estimates a contraction of 0.3% for the region in 2020, with 9 of our 14 members expected to post negative growth, which is quite unprecedented. To cope with this extraordinary situation, our members adopted the extraordinary policy measures, providing extensive fiscal and monetary policy support. The size of the stimulus packages range from 10% to 40% of GDP. In order to fund these fiscal packages, some governments have temporarily lifted the statutory ceiling of government debt. A number of central banks have started to actively purchase government bonds in the secondary market, and in some cases, even in the primary market. It is worth noting that the ASEAN countries are not facing the zero lower bound on their policy rates. Therefore, their bond purchase is not the same as the quantitative easing adopted by many central banks of advanced economies. Instead, these central banks are playing the role of market maker of last resort so that they can maintain the stability of the financial market even under a large increase of new bond issuance from the government on one hand, and withdrawal of foreign capital on the other. In some extreme cases, the government and the central bank went into a burden-sharing arrangement. Bank Indonesia has partly funded the stimulus packages by purchasing government bonds in the primary market. It also shared some of the interest burden with the government. All these bold measures were done under prudent principles, together with clear communication, and they have been well received by the market so far. With these extraordinary measures, it is clear that the governments in the region are pushing the limit of their macroeconomic policy making and stepping outside of their traditional comfort zone. Now let us see how these recent developments have impacted the financial stability in the region, and also how we as a region responded to the increase in risks and vulnerabilities. ASEAN Plus 3 is known for its active regional financial cooperation. The CMIM, with a total firepower of $240 billion, is the second largest RFA, only after ESM, the European Stability Mechanism. The CMIM, together with AMRO, is probably the only RFA with a full-fledged surveillance capability. And all these started from the Asian financial crisis. The Asian financial crisis profoundly changed the way the governments conduct their macroeconomic policies. They have found out the hard way that building up buffers and reserves is critically important in protecting themselves from external shocks. So, in addition to allowing the exchange rates to adjust more freely, they worked hard to achieve current account surplus and built up their foreign exchange reserves and engaged in prudent fiscal and monetary policies. The member countries also started using the capital flow management measures and macroprudential policy measures, catering to their country-specific circumstances to cope with the volatile cross-border capital flows. Given the recent events of sudden change in global capital flows, such as the Bernanke shock, our members have become sophisticated in using these instruments, which were quite effective in maintaining stability. On top of all these, the members have the CMIM as a regional insurance policy, providing them with some additional cushion. So the countries in the region were in relatively good shape going into the pandemic, with ample foreign reserves and adequate fiscal and monetary policy space. So despite the massive capital outflow during the February to March period, no country experienced any acute foreign exchange liquidity issue. And we continue to believe that the financial crisis in the region remains a tail risk with very limited likelihood. But that has not held us back from enhancing the effectiveness and the operational readiness of the CMIM. In September, the members reached a milestone agreement allowing members to access up to 40% of the CMIM without IMF co-financing and the option to use their own currencies. We have also been working closely with the IMF. We amended the CMIM agreement and agreed on an operational framework with the IMF to ensure smooth co-financing when needed. Looking ahead, the biggest challenge facing policymakers in the region today is to balance a trade-off between restoring growth while safeguarding financial stability and rebuilding policy space. Any eventual withdrawal of stimulus and forbearance measures must be measured and carefully executed. A premature exit carries a threat of potential cliff effects, while overly generous extended support could be detrimental to fiscal sustainability. A strong commitment to rebuilding policy space over the medium term is critical for maintaining policy credibility. The return to fiscal consolidation and unwinding of extraordinary monetary measures in the aftermath of the pandemic will be crucial for regaining market confidence. Now let me conclude. While the COVID-19 pandemic has brought chaos and exposed weaknesses, it also brings opportunities, catalyzing growth of the digital economy, strengthening the healthcare systems, just to name a few. While every country and region is different, the crisis reminds us to take stock, learn, and reset toward a stronger and more sustainable future. Thank you. Back to you, Mr. Nakao.
Thank you very much, Mr. Doi. In the interest of saving our time, I don't try to summarize it, but I would like a short comment. And we learned the lessons from the global financial crisis or even Asian financial crisis and liquidity provision, very active fiscal policies to be cooperative with the monetary policy, and the insurance and the guarantees for enterprises and of course to financial institutions, and also the MDBs and IMF and the regional frameworks have supported countries. And I think this time it worked quite well, but because of the nature of this crisis, which is a real crisis, and also we don't know when it will be ended and to what extent it can become even more serious. So even compared to the end of the war or disaster, we are still in the midst of the uncertainties, and it makes our kind of judgment more difficult. But if this can be ended someday, I think we must think about the sustainability of several things. And one is, of course, fiscal and monetary policies, and we have taken extraordinary measures to support enterprises and the household and regional, I mean, local authorities and so on. And I think even if there is a concern about the kind of supporting zombie or moral hazard, I think we should on the safe side, which means we should be more supportive to these institutions, these players, because without this pandemic, many of them can survive, and the cost of letting them go or bankrupt is even more damaging. So I think we can are on the safe side, and because people lose opportunities to spend for service and consumption and investment, there is more kind of saving in the countries. So those savings are used to buy government bonds. So there is no risk of interest rate hike or the government bond price collapse or foreign exchange collapse or inflation, because people don't spend, and we can use that for buying government bond. But this kind of equilibrium is not really stable, and as many people already mentioned, we should start thinking about redressing these situations once pandemic is over, but we are not sure when it will happen. That is one of the very important issues after this pandemic. And also we must pay attention to climate change sustainability issues and SDGs, and also social divide, which is becoming even more serious in many countries because of globalization, technological advancement. And on top of that, this pandemic makes a divide even wider. And we must also think about how to sustain international cooperation frameworks, multilateral system, although we may need some adjustment to the kind of a super hyper globalism. So this is my comment. And as Mr. Doi mentioned, I think after this pandemic is over, we should take advantage of the lessons from this crisis, including, as he said, we can think about how to strengthen our health system again, and also how we can use a new technology like digital technologies for work and life and education and so on. We did learn lessons from plague problem in 17th century, mass sewage and urban planning, and also even after the war, there was a positive step, although we should better avoid such a tragedy. But anyway, that is my comment, and I'd like to ask one question to each of you. And to Seira-san, you mentioned we don't need to rush to reconsolidate or to exit the emergency measures. Mr. Astray also mentioned it, but when can we start the consolidation? Some people mention modern monetary theory or something like we can spend as much, government spending as much as possible for foreseeable future because monetary policy will support it. But when can we seriously start the consolidation, or do we really need it? And that is my question. And to Mr. Kono, you mentioned that we need policies to ensure smooth functioning of the financial system. In a sense, we are encouraging financial institutions to lend more, to give more credit. And we are, in a sense, loosening some elements of regulations as a kind of emergency measures. So maybe financial institutions take a mixed message that do we really need to lose a kind of credit assessment, or we should be more strict. So it's a very difficult balance, isn't it? So I'd like to ask to what extent we should prepare for the crisis, or exposed kind of a quick action can play even more important role compared to the preparedness, because preparedness means the more capital, building up, and less credit extension to be prudent. So what is a balance? And Mr. Doi, I'd like to, you already mentioned so many things which I wanted to ask, How do you see the impact of US and China trade dispute? And of course, global value chain is the most important element of success of Asian economic development in these several decades. So how do you see the impact, and what is a possible solution or possible remedy to that? Of course, China can take a more moderate policies in many regards to avoid provoking America, and also Mr. Biden's policy can be a little bit different. But how do you see the possible remedy or advices to these issues? So, Seira-san, can you start from my question?
Thank you. Thank you very much, Nakao-san. This is a difficult question, when to start consolidation, because of course one doesn't want to, one wants to avoid the cliff effects of too early exit, but at the same time, one has to avoid the zombification of some of the firms or those that are supported. So it is a very difficult decision, and we don't have that much lessons from the past, right? Because if you think of earlier crisis, you basically have the crisis, you know what you inherited, you can do diagnostics, you can do asset quality reviews and so on and so forth, and then you would have a strategy and hopefully you can follow your strategy in dealing with insolvent firms and also if there are any insolvent financial institutions. In this crisis, we have a lot of uncertainty, not only about the pandemic and what turn it will take and how long it will take to get out of the crisis, but we also have a lot of uncertainty as to what one would call T plus one looks like. So what are structural changes in the economy that would be the case, so that would also determine what is solvent, what is not solvent going forward. So, for example, tourism, what will happen to tourism industry? What will happen with digital acceleration of use of digital in terms of different services, how they are, the contact related services and so on. So I think what I'm trying to say is good crisis managers always learn as they go and they reoptimize. So this is going to be really the case in this crisis, that we as was said very well, on the side of being careful and prudent and not exiting too fast from some of these stimulus packages, to make sure that illiquid firms, but solvent, viable firms and institutions can still survive. That is, given the low for long interest rates and the fiscal space in many countries, that makes it more feasible to be able to do so. At the same time, and I'll end with this, there are two very key issues in my mind. One is the word regulatory forbearance was used earlier. I think Masa-san used it. I always cringe when I hear that word, because I think it's important to provide the room and provide regulatory space. But we have to make sure that it's done in a transparent and accountable way, so that we also look at the implications and take measures as needed. So whatever we relax, we do it in a way that is accountable and transparent, and also make sure that we put in place the insolvency regimes, out-of-court settlements, and institutions that may be needed in case we see a larger number of bankruptcies going forward. Thank you.
Seira-san, you don't buy the idea of a modern monetary theory type idea. We can spend as much as possible.
Well, I think we have to be careful. We do have low for long interest rates, and that means R minus G is in the favor of being able to borrow and use that to actually use the multipliers. But I think we have to be very careful, because it doesn't apply to every country. Initial conditions are different. So I think it does apply in some countries, and it gives the room to take actions, especially given the pandemic. But in some countries, that's not the case, because they don't face necessarily low interest rates at this point in time.
And also, I presume that even countries which can use that kind of idea, we cannot continue to this forever.
Yeah. Yeah. And to just end, I talked about concerted infrastructure push, especially green, sustainable. And we have Masa-san here from OECD. We have been working also very closely with them and the World Bank and others in terms of governance, infrastructure governance. I think state capacity is very important as well. So if these, you know, for debt to be good debt, that it leads to growth, it needs to be spent in a way that really enhances growth capacity. And I think that's really critical.
Okay, thank you very much. So Mr. Kono, about financial regulations.
Oh, yes. Well, thank you. First, Sheila, I don't think I'm the one who used the word the regulatory forbearance, because I'm also a bit allergic to that term. But on the other hand, during the GFC and in its aftermath, I did argue against the too rapid tightening of regulation. But this was more because, of course, we could have really been, in a way, exacerbating the pro-cyclical movement of markets and deepening the credit crunch and so on. So, at least I hope I didn't use it unless I was daydreaming. On the other hand, Nakao-san, your question is quite interesting, but let's say if I go back to the broader picture, our economic outlook will be coming out in a week's time, but it looks like this is going to be a protracted crisis, or at least the recovery will be a very slow and long one, meaning that there will be inevitably much more non-performing loans on the books of the banks. And of course, banks will need to cope with that if we want to really somehow keep the financial flows from being disrupted and falling into another deep credit crunch. So in that sense, maybe it is certainly not the time to tighten regulation, but at the same time, when we certainly use those buffers, we should be rather cautious because of this prospect of a protracted downturn of the economy that seems to be lying ahead of us. And one point I would like to add is about climate change, because climate change is not waiting for us to go out of this crisis. So we are already calling on governments to take any stimulus measure or stimulus package that can be as green as possible, in the sense that combining grants, loans, and tax relief directed towards greener transport or facilitating a circular economy, and also fiscal support or financial support for energy efficiency and renewable energy. And Sheila, you did mention this investment gap. This is huge, and we have to have private finance somehow come in to support this huge investment need. And so we need to promote ESG finance. And for ESG finance to flourish, of course, we need much better disclosure, much better standardization, better labeling, better methodologies. The list is long, but we can do better in terms of international standards in that respect. Shall I stop here?
Okay, thank you very much. Mr. Doi.
Thank you very much. You mentioned about the US-China trade tension, and it seems like a so distant past that we were discussing this issue, because it has been more or less overshadowed by the pandemic situation. But you're right, in 2019, the biggest issue in this region was the US-China trade tension. And in fact, it had a very big impact on most of the economies, and perhaps with the exception of Vietnam, all the economies were negatively impacted from this US-China trade tension. And especially your smaller open economies like Hong Kong, Singapore, indeed went through a very hot period. And it also had a profound impact on the value chain because many firms were trying to relocate their factories out of China to some other countries. And also the pandemic also had a very important impact on the global value chain in this region. So we are very much focusing on this global value chain and how it's changing and how it is impacting the dynamic in the region. And as a matter of fact, one of the issues that we will deal in the regional economic outlook report that we'll issue next March will be on this global value chain issue and how it's changing, how it will impact the economy in the region. And you mentioned what would be the solution for this US-China trade tension. And this obviously, I mean, to provide a answer to this is beyond me, but I guess one of the positive developments that we can witness is quite recently, I think members in the region, including some other members, signed the RCEP trade agreement. So I'm not sure whether how much an impact this RCEP will have, but I guess this will generate some kind of movement toward multilateralism. And we heard media reports indicating China is interested in joining TPP. And with all these, we haven't heard anything from the US about their new trade policies, but it's possible that they may want to rejoin TPP. So I guess we should be hopeful that there will be renewed interest in this multilateralism rather than doing everything unilaterally. Trying to engage in a more multilateral system is something that we should be looking forward to. Thank you.
Thank you very much. As you said, I think it's encouraging that RCEP is agreed, and including ASEAN countries plus Australia and New Zealand. And of course, we can easily criticize some insufficiency of such arrangement, but it's nice to see the cooperative multilateral framework is progressing, so that is my impression. And also, there is one question from Sri Lanka official. So, is there any unconventional strategy for highly indebted emerging economies? And because I have been dealing with the debt issues at the Ministry of Finance and at ADB, I'll quickly mention that there is no easy solution. We are now discussing debt relief, but if there is a total debt reduction, it will damage a country's borrowing capacity in the future. And also, we need to take transparent and collective actions, including such countries like China, which is not a member of Paris Club or OECD arrangement. So that is my answer. There is no easy one size fit all response to this kind of issues of a highly indebted country. So by that, I'll end this session, and thank you very much for making interesting discussions. Thank you very much.
A big thank you to Mr. Nakao and to all of the panelists. We greatly benefited from your discussion and insights on measures and instruments to strengthen international and regional cooperation, and also to secure financial stability going forward. So thank you again from all of us. Now we would like to move on to the second session of this evening, Adapting Crisis Tools to a Changing Financial Landscape. The moderator for this session is Ms. Patricia Moser, professor at the School of International and Public Affairs, Columbia University. Trish will also introduce the panelists. The floor is yours, Trish. Please give us a few moments while we switch and connect all of the panelists. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Thank you, Jonathan. And thank you to the University of Tokyo and the IMF for including me in this excellent event. As Jonathan mentioned, I run a program in central banking and financial policy at Columbia University. But for many years in my career, I was a central banker, and I worked a lot on financial stability and crisis management. So it's wonderful to be part of this event, which is incredibly constructive and useful, I think. So I'm going to pick up on something that Kono-san said in the last panel, and I want to thank him for this. One thing that we all know is that the financial system is constantly adapting and innovating. This has been particularly true in the last 10 years with the expansion of both market-based credit formation, expansions of non-banks, not only non-banks that are bank-like, if you like, in their activities, but also financial market infrastructures, and of course, a dizzyingly wide array of new digital or fintech firms as well. On the other hand, the vast majority of traditional crisis management tools and the regulation around them are often focused on the banking sector. That's true for individual countries, and it's true very often in international cooperative arrangements as well. So this panel is a chance to talk about how crisis management tools have already been adapted and may have to continue to adapt even more to the structural changes and the innovations in the financial system. We have three really excellent panelists to talk about these issues. The first will be Robin Brooks, who is a managing director and chief economist at the Institute for International Finance. The second will be Shinsuke Shirakawa, the vice commissioner for strategy development and management at Japan's Financial Services Agency. And the last will be Kenichi Ueda, associate professor at the University of Tokyo and one of the organizers of this event. So thank you all. I greatly appreciate it. And I'll turn the floor over to Robin.
Thank you so much. It's great to be part of this event. It's a real privilege to be invited. My thanks go to all the organizers and my good friend and former colleague, Kenichi Ueda. So I am going to share a few slides. Bear with me one second. I'm not exactly an expert at this. Okay, one second. Okay, I hope you can all see that. So we're going to be talking today on this panel about the financial landscape, how things are changing, and what lessons, if any, we can learn from the happenings in recent months. So I thought that I would talk in particular about some of the dislocations that we've seen earlier this year. Obviously, when we have a negative shock, and COVID-19 certainly qualifies as that, it is always interesting from a forensic perspective to look at what happens in financial markets. And obviously, there were many things going on earlier this year. We had talk of dollar shortages, and we had the telltale signs of those dollar shortages in financial markets, for example, widening in cross-currency basis in major currency pairs, but also in emerging markets. But perhaps the most fundamental disruption that happened was in the US Treasury market. And you will obviously all appreciate that the US Treasury market, in a way, is the benchmark market for the global financial system. It is the deepest, most liquid financial market. It is the basis for pricing all kinds of other contracts and derivatives. And so it is worth talking in particular about what happened there. Now, you will remember, and this is now becoming the focus of an increasing number of studies, which is really good. You will remember that in March and April, there was a brief episode where, as the S&P 500 was falling, and along with the S&P 500, global equity markets were falling, US Treasury yields actually rose for a few weeks. And this was basically a sign of huge dislocations in the US Treasury market. It was very counterintuitive. You should, as a Fed is shifting dovish and doing all kinds of things to support the economy, as the economic outlook is worsening, see lower yields, not higher yields. And so this was a classic telltale sign of disruption. Now, what I'm showing you in the left chart on this slide is what happened as a result. It is from the US flow of funds, a complete and full decomposition of US Treasury supply. So that's what I'm calling total issuance versus demand. So versus purchases. And the key thing that you will be able to see here is that in Q1, there were different kinds of sellers. There were foreign sellers, that's pink. So that's basically foreign central banks who are selling treasuries to intervene in their currencies to provide essentially dollar liquidity to markets. So that's good, we like that. That's exactly what central banks are supposed to do. But then we also have a category, households, which is really a misnomer because it includes hedge funds and non-bank entities. And what we saw earlier this year is that there were very leveraged spread trades in some of these areas that blew up essentially when you had this shock in March and April. As a result, we had huge unprecedented purchases by the Federal Reserve to restore market functioning. And that is what you can see in the blue bars. And the scale of these purchases is really quite unprecedented. You had a run rate of $700 billion in purchases per month. To give you an idea, QE1 back in 2009 when it was announced was $300 billion. QE2 in November 2010 was $600 billion. So in 1 month, we did far more in terms of purchasing securities to calm down this market dislocation than we did in these big high visibility QE programs. In other words, the market dislocation was extreme, and it was largely due to two factors. It was due to spillback from emerging markets. So that's the selling of treasuries by foreign central banks. That's, as I said, benign. But then it is leverage in non-bank institutions, which is not benign. And so I think this is going to be going forward as we digest and clean up. We will need to study this episode very, very carefully. In particular, as you can see in the right chart, because we have low forever now in financial markets, the right chart shows you the path of the Fed funds target for the Federal Reserve. You can see there the projected path from the June and September dot projections that the Federal Reserve publishes. And then you can see market pricing, and the market is not expecting interest rate hikes on any horizon from the Federal Reserve. So some of the underlying reasons for this buildup in leverage and for this arbitrage trading that stems from low for long rates in the wake of the global financial crisis, we're again seeing. And so the burden on regulating non-bank institutions is going to grow going forward. I just want to say in closing a few things about the flip side of this. As you know, I mentioned EM central banks and their selling of treasuries at the height of the COVID shock. Now, the IIF has a lot of expertise in tracking global capital flows. Again, some of these, most of these, in fact, are due to non-bank financial institutions and asset managers in the balance of payments. This is equivalent to non-resident portfolio flows into emerging market stocks and bonds. And you can see here In the left chart, the magnitude of capital outflows earlier this year, on a quarterly basis, they were in Q1, that's the black line, around $70 billion in outflows, completely unprecedented and far in excess of any previous shock that we've seen in the global financial crisis, notably 2015, 2016, when there were concerns about RMB devaluation, and then, this is not shown on the chart, much bigger than what we saw in the global financial crisis. So the positive news is, from the global financial system perspective, given these large outflows, the system actually acquitted itself quite well. We had large adjustment in prices. We did have temporarily dislocations in some markets, in particular cross-currency basis, but those faded quite quickly. And I think this is to the credit of the Federal Reserve, because it is a spillover from the large asset purchases and a normalization risk appetite. So where are we now? If we look at these flows in Q4 2020, we're actually seeing flows at the strongest pace since the immediate years after the global financial crisis. So we're seeing normalization, which in large part is driven by none of the things that policymakers are doing, but it is news of a COVID vaccine. And so fingers crossed, we're looking at normalization in financial markets. So my two main points are: the decade post-global financial crisis, low rates for long caused a buildup of leverage in non-bank financial institutions in the treasury market. I think that deserves a lot of study and focus and potentially a regulatory response, but obviously we're in the data discovery phase. On a broader basis, the global financial markets acquitted themselves quite well, even in the face of the massive capital outflows earlier this year. So let me stop there, Patricia.
Thank you, Robin. I'll turn it over now to Shunsuke Shirakawa from the JFSA.
Yes, thank you very much, Patricia. Thank you very much for inviting me to this conference. I'm very pleased to be here. Let me see. My slides are on. I hope so. The theme of this panel is to discuss how we can adapt crisis tools to a changing financial landscape. The majority of crisis management tools to deal with financial crisis have been crafted or reviewed after the global financial crisis, which occurred in 2008. Therefore, I would like to look back the history of G20's financial regulatory reform efforts. In the aftermath of the global financial crisis, G20 leaders first discussed ways to deal with the meltdown of the global financial market, as well as its enormous impact on the global economy. They agreed on coordinated macroeconomic policies as emergency measures. After global financial markets have been stabilized, they started to discuss ways to prevent another financial crisis in the future. In 2009, the third G20 Leaders Summit in Pittsburgh presented the blueprint of the post-GFC regulatory reforms. They established the FSB, a new international organization composed of treasuries, central banks, and regulatory authorities of major countries, and delegated it to lead and coordinate discussions on global financial regulatory reforms. There are four areas of regulatory reforms. First one is more capital and liquidity. the Basel Committee strengthened capital and liquidity international rules in three steps. First, Basel 2.5 focused on securitization, and Basel 3 strengthened the quantity and the quality of bank capital, and Basel 3 finalization strengthened the risk calculations. And second area is no more too big to fail. FSB tried to make resolution of SIFIs, systemically important financial institutions, easier, and they addressed moral hazard issues. They agreed on SIFI surcharge, TLAC, total loss absorption capacity, and RRP, resolution and recovery plans. And then we are also talking about resolution regimes in each jurisdiction. The third area is OTC derivatives. FSB tried to make derivatives market safer, simpler, and more transparent. We agreed on mandatory central clearing. We also agreed on margin requirements for bilateral trades. And also we agreed on trade repositories and trading platforms. The fourth area is shadow banking. The FSB first tried to designate non-bank, non-insurance SIFIs, but they couldn't reach consensus. So now we are shifting our focus from entity-based approach to activity-based approach, but the reforms are still ongoing. Consequently, the core of the global financial system became much more resilient by last year. However, the pandemic of COVID-19 has put the global financial system under considerable strain. The turmoil of financial markets in March, Robin just mentioned, revealed vulnerabilities still remaining in global financial markets. Structural changes in the financial system over the past decade, which are partly caused by the G20 regulatory reforms themselves, have increased the reliance on market-based financial intermediation in order to finance growing levels of global debt. The share of the non-bank sector in the total financial intermediation globally now accounts for almost 50%. Major authorities have taken decisive measures, including provision of abundant liquidity into the short-term funding market to deal with the March turmoil. After they succeeded in calming down the market, the FSB and relevant authorities started a holistic review of the turmoil. As a result, they identified deficiencies in the non-bank sector, such as liquidity mismatches and excessive leverage taken by investment funds. As the March turmoil has underscored the need to strengthen resilience in the non-bank sector, in particular, MMF, money market funds, and open-ended funds. The FSB is expected to examine and address individual risk factors of these specific markets. For example, some types of open-ended funds, especially those invested in illiquid assets, misaligned with their redemption policies, should be susceptible to large outflows. At the same time, we should not lose sight of the increasing interconnectedness, both within the non-bank sector and with banks. For example, many non-banks rely on banking system for credit and backstop liquidity. We must understand what kind of vulnerabilities are emerging against the changing landscape of the non-bank sector and how shocks are transmitted to or from the banking sector. Therefore, the FSB is also expected to monitor such new dynamics of global markets and examine structural issues threatening the stability of the financial system. Thank you very much, and I will be happy to answer any question. Back to you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Shirakawa-san. Next, I'm turning it over to Kenichi Ueda, who I believe is going to what's on the horizon in particular.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Patricia. And also Robin, my longtime friend, thank you very much for joining. And also I'm Shirakawa-san, thank you very much. I'm an organizer at the U Tokyo side, and it was originally we kind of proposed to have this kind of meeting in last March, but because of COVID, it's postponed and become online. But it become, because of that, I think it's become getting better, because we now, last March, we haven't really having a COVID crisis yet, but now we have another kind of crisis in a bad for most of the people, but for like us, it's something like it's a time to think about more carefully and deeper. That's a kind of, in a sense, it's good. I mean, it's bad for everyone, but in a sense, it's good for our professional thinkers, I hope. And anyway, I would like to share about my stuff here and slideshow. So I'm talking about digital finance side and payments, something more like not currently happening, not really happening, replacing all the financial system yet, but it's currently happening right now. I think it's a version after GFC, obviously, as you know, and reinforced during COVID-19 because people are more and more people doing online shopping. Obviously, we have to pay online. And then traditional banking and commercial banking is a maturity transformation plus payment service. Maturity transformation is something like taking deposits in a demand short-term kind of deposit, and then lending long-term loans to companies as well as household mortgages, and plus payment services. That's kind of traditional banking kind of business. But payments fintech, I mean, fintech companies like, you know, those famous ones, recent ones, and financials, for example. And everywhere in Japan, it's called PayPay, or everywhere, those payments specialized fintechs kind of replacing banks' payment services. That's happening right now, has been happening. And I believe that really three reasons. One is obviously they have a kind of better, newer technologies, and that's creating their services speedier and cheaper compared to traditional banks. The second issue also kind of people are kind of implying or mentioning already, but we do know after GFC, traditional banks' regulation gets tighter, stronger, which is actually good if we think about financial stability, especially banking sector stability. But because of that, seems they do somewhat regulation, so-called regulation cost that the banks have to pay increased. Compared to them, those payment service fintechs are not under that kind of bank regulation. That's why compared to traditional banks, looks like they have lower regulatory cost. That's one thing we have to think about it. And then other one is also, well, Japan, even before GFC, but in many advanced countries, and some EMs, I believe, after GFC, monetary policy is essentially creating zero deposit rates. So if the deposit, I mean, payment service, if we use payment service, we still put some money on those payment service fintech companies. But those fintech companies, usually it's difficult to give us a positive interest rate. So if the banks give us a positive interest, positive deposit rate, we still would like to use deposits to earn a positive interest rate and then use as a payment. But because of zero deposit rate, there's not such a kind of benefit of putting our money on a bank deposit compared to the positive deposit rate era we have seen like 10 years or 20 years ago. So that's another kind of issues we have to think about. Where this payments fintech strength coming from, this kind of increase in service, whether it's sustainable, or if not sustainable, what would be happening? Then at the same time, I have to also say, however, traditional banks could often benefit from this kind of development, obviously. One is, for example, when we think about regulation of banks, that usually economists like us think about. It is because without some kind of protection like deposit insurance, or sometimes we could maybe bailouts in an extreme case, but anyway, something like deposit insurance is needed to stop kind of bank run type situation for banks. Bank run, however, happens when the ordinary people, depositor think, sees that other people run the bank. That's why I have to run the bank too. The bank is difficult to prevent. That's why we deposit insurance is provided to make sure ordinary depositors, there is no need to run the banks because their deposits are safe. But in the end, if the banks themselves can utilize, like for example, dynamic pricing for free withdrawal fee contingent on real-time aggregate deposit withdrawal, then that could prevent bank run. In a sense, that require more technology advancement, I believe. But if, in a sense, minute by minute, bank knows how many people withdrawing, and if more than expected people become coming to withdraw, they could raise the withdrawal fee. Then depositors think, well, it's right now it, the withdrawal fee is high, so maybe it's better to wait until the withdrawal fee coming down. So it's like that kind of pricing could become possible if this kind of technology advanced more. And that maybe actually giving more stability in the banking system, and perhaps there's less involvement of deposit insurance or bailouts could be happening. That's one kind of, I hope, to happen, that kind of situation. But anyway, that's another future in the benefit side. And then when we talk about payment system, one of the payment system we use in a long time is a cash, right? Cash bill. And the cash, as you know, many people know, it's also another topic has been discussed in this international as well as domestic context, is a central bank digital currencies. And many people think that's replacing cash, but because this is digital, it could replace bank deposits. Then that's a huge issue for the banking sector, as we know now, because if it's substitute bank deposit, obviously banks it's become difficult to kind of survive in a sense. But of course, at the same time, we do know that's a difficult issue at the same time, because even if the central bank do not or will not introduce digital currency for retail purposes, still we do know crypto assets, that's like private sector digital currencies, are already there. And then of course many people argue crypto assets like Bitcoins are not really utilized as a transaction, but as you know, one issue stable coins like Libra backed by Dara or something else need a currency board type kind of arrangement that need to monitor and supervise. That's why it's difficult. So many places it's not really good, has been considered as not a good idea and somewhat regulated against it. But unstable coins like Bitcoin, unstable coins not really backed by any hard currencies, but still people trade like Bitcoin, Ethereum, and Ripple is the three major currencies. And that's how people say its value is not really stable. So anyway, people don't use it. It's just used for the investment or speculation. But it's the thing is that it's this daily return 50-day moving average 2016 to 2020 showing after at least 2019 or half late 2018, since that it's actually volatility of those Bitcoin, Ethereum, Ripple is quite similar to gold S&P 500 index. Actually, if I did some more statistical analysis and showing indeed statistically so, that means these even unstable coins could be started to be used as a medium exchange, which we do know PayPal already, the company called PayPal already picked up Bitcoin or other major crypto assets as a medium of exchange too. So those things, again, coming back to attacking some dominance of banking sectors, traditional banking, this payment system services. And that's kind of all, I believe it's an innovation. So it's good for everyone, but at the same time, at least for the short run or medium run, it's a financial stability point of view, we have to be cautious about how to approach them. Thank you very much.
Thank you all. So I have a couple of questions, which I think we have just enough time for, if I'm checking my clock correctly here. And I want to pick up on a point that actually all three of you made about the current COVID economic crisis. And one interpretation of the COVID financial turmoil is that it has put a real spotlight on liquidity risks. Obviously, the traditional financial stability vulnerabilities, leverage, maturity transformation, all of those things are clearly still there and they played a role. But market-based finance in particular is particularly vulnerable to liquidity. And by this, I don't mean necessarily funding liquidity, but literally an ability to convert your assets into cash. The examples that Robin gave and that Shirakawa-san gave on mutual fund flows in particular, very in the United States, just enormous sales of outflows in effectively completely unlevered mutual funds, but created both turmoil in the treasury market or contributed to the turmoil in the treasury market as well as in the corporate bond market, the emerging market flows and their sheer speed, both by governments and by investors, would all seem to sort of reinforce this point. So I have a couple questions for you. First of all, do you agree with the statement I just made that more attention on liquidity risks, perhaps in financial stability and in crisis management, is warranted? And if you do, then what do you think this tells us about crisis management needs on the part of central banks and governments. Does this mean that central banks are even more increasingly going to be dealers of last resort as well as lenders of last resort? That was for anybody. Robin, you want to go first?
Sure. Trisha, I think those are great questions. So the distinction between liquidity and solvency and what policymakers should do are really the two key issues. In real time, I and many others struggle to tell the difference between liquidity and solvency.
You're not alone on that.
The one example is the emerging market space. And I think there are many, many examples, the treasury market as well, Patricia, as you mentioned. But the talk earlier this year about dollar shortages and funding shortages, which is really a umbrella term for liquidity disruption, I think glossed over the fact that the economic fundamentals of many of these countries were deteriorating sharply, right? So many of these countries, for example, are commodity exporters. And so the terms of trade of these commodity exporters deteriorated significantly because oil prices and other commodity prices fell. And so it was perfectly reasonable for the currencies, the bonds, the equities of these countries to fall. So where do we draw the line between a liquidity event and a repricing? I think it's very difficult. And what worries me is that we, and this is where I'm going to transition to policy now. In the moment, you know, inevitably, policymakers don't want to be left being the ones holding the bag, right? You don't want to be causing a recession. You don't want to cause financial conditions to tighten even more. So the bias in policy, I think rightly, in the moment of crisis is to provide liquidity and prevent financial conditions from making a bad shock even worse. But the problem that we have is that ex post, we often do not revisit. We have lifted people who took exorbitant risk out of their positions. We've made them whole, essentially. And that skews risk-taking. And it's the same age-old question, Patricia, that's bedeviled us since the beginning. And we have, I think it's fair to say, not really arrived at the answer. So why is this now so important? It's because in the end, all this is about risk-taking. It's about return generation. And we have, you know, a low forever world. So the fundamental challenge is bigger than ever.
Thank you.
Yes, Patricia.
Yes, please.
Thank you. I think I agree with you. Liquidity risk is getting more attention from the global financial regulators and supervisors. It is because from the experience in March this year, we learned that there is some deficiencies in liquidity risk management by major fund managers. We probably need to strengthen our supervision on their liquidity risk management by fund managers. However, we need some caveat in order to strengthen our regulations or supervisions. One reason is that the global markets are diverse. We cannot introduce one-size-fits-all regulations to each market. We need to look at the situations and players in each market. So it is not so easy to agree upon one single solutions in this area. And another issue is that there are other elements of risks in non-bank sector as well. For example, we need to think about the excessive leverage taken by some fund managers. So we need to think about the robustness of the bond markets or corporate bond markets as well. So it's not easy again. And the second point I want to raise is that if we take the central bank intervention as granted, it is very dangerous. We already see some sign of moral hazard. So we need to be careful how we can deal with these risks from more ex-ante by ex-ante measures, such as liquidity risk management tools for fund managers and others. These are my answers. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes.
Kenichi, please.
Yes, I believe that the two issues, it's about very kind of narrow sense fund, some kind of investment funds, money market funds issues, or more broadly speaking, liquidity versus insolvency issues. And then I believe it's in a very narrow sense, Shirakawa-san's, what Shirakawa says, I believe it's quite right. And I'm not so expert on very narrow sense, but in a broader sense, for example, Seira in a first session talked about insolvency. I think she's more talking about insolvency in a corporate and perhaps in a mortgages, a household. And those difference between the liquidity and insolvency is that I believe the debt overhang issue, if we, and it's same as sovereign, if the creditors agree to reduce the debt burden, then that corporate or sovereign or household could really become vital to contribute more on the economy and more active in the economic sense. And that, if that's the case, it's an insolvency issue, I believe, not just a providing liquidity issue. That's all.
Thank you. I think very quickly, we may have just a couple of minutes for one more question. And this may be more for Kenichi than it is for the other two, but your other two panelists are welcome to comment. Your comments about digital currencies and combined with some points that were made earlier today by Celia and others about the unevenness and inequitable ways sometimes that the policy response, crisis policy responses actually get spread amongst the economies. Do you think that digital currencies, particularly central bank digital currencies, are a way to actually make that policy response a little less uneven in the future?
My talk is more about we have to be cautious about central bank digital currencies because it could suddenly disrupting a traditional banking system. The second, after whatever happening in the very future, if people utilize the digital currency system, it's kind of difficult to say. So for example, when we use a computer now, it's obviously it's a fast computer. It's, I think, used as a vacuum, a transistor, a big one. And then it become IC chip and LSI. And those, however, technological advancement make everything quick and everything quite present for every users. I think money isn't something like this. So it's obviously it's compared to the current paper cash, it's obviously great, but it's in essence from the economics point of view, in essence, it's not so much different from now compared to, you know, very long term future, I believe. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So thank you, all three panelists. I greatly appreciate you taking part in this and sharing your insights. I'm quite sure that we're out of time or almost, and so I'll turn it back over to Jonathan Dunn. Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Trish, and Shirakawa-san, Robin, and Ueda-sensei. I'm sure that everyone in our audience has learned a lot from your deliberations and discussion. And I think I really liked the notion that you introduced of that the risks of shocks passing back and forth between banks and non-bank financial institutions is rising for the various reasons you mentioned, and therefore the importance of thinking about how to adapt crisis tools to help manage those risks is a key thing. So thank you very much for this panel and for your discussion. Let me just conclude the night by saying that tomorrow we will have Mr. Ryozo Himino, who is the commissioner of the Financial Services Agency for Japan, for the opening speech. Then Mr. Tobias Adrian, director of the Monetary and Capital Markets Department of the IMF, will give a presentation on sustaining financial health during the crisis and also during the road to recovery. And then we will have a panel discussion on financial regulatory measures during the GFC, the global financial crisis, and lessons and measures for this crisis, the COVID-19 crisis. That will be moderated by Yoshihiro Kawai, a visiting professor of the University of Tokyo, and also one of our co-organizers. So thank you to everybody for joining us today. We'll see you tomorrow again at 9 p.m. Tokyo time. So please have a good night or a good day wherever you are. Thank you very much.